Hello and welcome to Good Game, the show for gamers by gamers. I'm Junglist.
And I'm Kapowski. Tonight we get some tips on a game that makes heaps of appearances at LAN tournaments, Need for Speed Most Wanted.
We talk to a guy who gets paid to play games.
We meet the guys behind the game Dystopia. It's a really cool mod for Half-Life 2 that's currently in progress. Oh, Junky, first things first though, we've got to hit gamers news.
Hit it! Film director and Halo player Peter Jackson has announced to the world his vision of the future of gaming at the XO6 conference in Spain.
There's a new form of entertainment that's not a game and it's not a film. It's a filmic game experience. But I wouldn't even call these games in my mind because I'm not a game designer. I mean, I enjoy games and there are great game designers. It's not me. But what I'm really interested in is the idea of taking ideas and stories that could become films, but maybe they won't be films. I think that we're right on the threshold of being able to design a new way to tell stories.
Counter-Strike Source Team RPM walked away as Sydney's champions last weekend. Team 96, a 1.6 team, gave them a tough run in the final. Congrats, guys.
And at the XO6 conference in Spain, it was announced that Ensemble Studios, developers of the Age of series, would be responsible for the new Halo RTS game. Halo Wars.
If they want war, we'll give them war.
Most gamers were surprised and excited to learn the next installment would be an RTS. Still, some were skeptical when they found out it was to be released exclusively to the 360.
This week, we'll be looking at motherboards. The motherboard is the backbone to the computer, so make sure you choose one that will perform well. You'll need to find a motherboard that matches your CPU's make and specifications, so look around. For a gaming machine, you're going to want a motherboard that supports multiple graphics cards.
Other things that you should look for are plenty of USB ports, 8 or more SATA ports, 2 IDE channels, so you can connect optical drives, and gigabit LAN. While this is only a general list, you should figure out exactly what you require before you make any purchases. As a general rule, it's better to have more features than you want than too few. Once you have selected your motherboard and installed your CPU and heatsink onto it, you can put it into the case. Before you put it in, pop the rear I/O panel out of the case and put the one included with your motherboard in. For most motherboards, you will need 9 standard computer screws as well as brass standoffs that screw into the case. There are standard locations for each of these screws, and most cases come with these holes marked as ATX or A. Screw the standoffs into the case. Insert the motherboard back first, and then screw the motherboard down. Generally, it's easier to start at the top rear of the motherboard and work your way around. Try and screw each screw down so that it's just loose enough to allow the motherboard to move slightly while putting the other screws in. Then screw all the screws down tightly together at the end.
Next week, we'll take a look at RAM, what type you'll need to match your system, as well as how to install it correctly.
All right, gamers, here's a harder one for you. Can you name this game? Here's a hint, it was released in 1988 in the US and Japan. Good luck.
Good game.
A lot of great games have started off as modifications for existing games. Natural Selection, Team Fortress Classic.
Don't forget Counter-Strike, yeah?
These are all mods for Half-Life. There's some minor mods that just play around with the interface. World of Warcraft is a great example of this. Then there's bigger mods which create a whole new game entirely. Usually, a developer will include a kit that makes it easier to mod the game. Then it's up to you to create whatever you want to create using that game engine. This here's Dystopia. It's a mod for Half-Life 2. A lot of people don't realize that Team Dystopia reside in our very own Brisbane. Rob! What's up, man?
Hey, Jungles, how you doing?
Dustin.
Hey, Jungles, how you going?
How you going, man? What you guys up to?
We're playing some Dystopia.
I'm here with Dustin and Rob from Dystopia. Thanks, guys, for joining us on Good Game. Now, for starters, what is Dystopia?
Well, Dystopia is a Half-Life 2 mod that we've been working on for the last couple of years. The original concept behind it was all cyberpunk-based, so we've pulled a lot of influences from the old-school cyberpunk books and things, tried to bring that into a first-person shooter type of environment. The whole concept is the punk team attacking corp installations and hacking into their network, busting things open, letting their troops come through and destroying whatever they're trying to destroy on various maps.
And what exactly is a mod?
Well, a mod's a modification of a retail game. In this case, Dystopia is a mod for Half-Life 2, which Valve Software developed, and along with the actual game, they released a software development kit that anybody's able to download and work on, basing off their engine, which is the source engine from Half-Life 2, and building up their own game, which gives us a leg up as amateur developers. We obviously don't have the time to create our own engine right from scratch, and so it allows us to get our hands on the latest sort of technology and get our gameplay ideas out to the public.
Do the manufacturers, in this case Valve, support you?
They support us a lot, and they've done a lot to help us wherever they can. They're very busy people, but you know, they flew us over to Seattle for a week to help us, give us some feedback on the game design. And we're in constant contact with emails when we come into troubles with any programming or technical problems that we have. But you know, for Valve in particular, they've had a proven track record of helping mods with things like Counter-Strike and Day of Defeat, which started out as mods, and they've taken them on board because they were so popular and such good products.
And tell us about your trip to meet Valve.
Well, we were contacted by Mike DeSalt, who is the lead engine coder from Valve, and he was a big Cyberpunk fan. He stumbled across the Dystopia site and just fell in love with it, kind of thing. So he became our real angel over there. Yeah, they were sort of surprised by how ambitious we were, I guess. They were expecting that, yeah, we would just be doing something quite simple, like changing the weapons and making a simple mod as opposed to a total conversion. So we had big ideas, and they kind of helped us trim that down into something more manageable.
So tell us about the team behind Dystopia.
There's probably a core group of about 12 or so people. Part of the thing about working on a mod is that, you know, nobody's getting paid. Everyone's doing it in their spare time. And so people sometimes have real life get in the way. Sometimes people just drop off the face of the earth. You lose contact with them and they were working on something. But originally it was a core group of our friends who we were all in clans with and were friends with, and other people have contributed little bits and pieces on the side.
So no one's actually getting paid on this project. Why do you guys do it?
It's just a game that we always wanted to play. We had you know, played so many games and picked out so many flaws and things that we would have done differently. And so we put all our ideas together and figured, you know, no one's going to make this game for us, so we'll do it ourselves.
The big draw card was to learn about games development and actually get a real appreciation for the amount of time and effort that goes into making a game. Trying to organise people that are in the UK and America, different time zones, it's quite a challenge. And I guess that's the bit that we were very naive about, was the difficulty and the challenge of that side of it.
Now, Dustin, you're the lead programmer on this one. Do you have anything in the game that you've put in there just for you, only you can use?
Well, there is one weapon that didn't quite make the cut. We did originally build a physics gun, but we found that people were exploiting with it too much, you know, stacking stuff in front of doors, so it got cut in place of the ion cannon, but it is still in the main build, and it is a weapon that is tied to my Steam account and I can access sometimes in pub servers. If I get the weapon and then somebody kills me, it drops on the ground and so someone else can pick it up. And so there's always this continual struggle to try and pick the gun up and throw stuff around.
So do you get killed a lot as a result?
Yes, whenever I get the gun out, people figure it out and then kill me straight away. So, you know, it's good fun.
Do you have anything new you can show us?
Yeah, we can show you a new level from version 1. So this is still in beta, but yeah, this map's called Undermine. Maybe a guy goes by the handle of Twin Cannon, who was a fan who made a map for us and proved his worth, and now he's, yeah, doing some big things. Like you see, Cyberspace is very more detailed now.
Nice.
But he's an American guy, so he's one of the ones that we have a bit of problems with the whole time issue, and he's quite often up until 3 a.m.
So what's the current state of the modding scene? Is it anything like it was years ago in the good old days of Half-Life and Quake?
I think a lot of people are struggling because they are biting off more than they can actually chew. They've got these big, massive, bold ideas, and when it actually comes to actually realising it, it's way too much, and they get a bit frustrated and fed up with it. And so you see a lot of mods die, but I think it's solidified the talent, I guess, into big teams. It's very rewarding. It's an incredible feeling when you see hundreds of people playing your game and getting some thrill out of it. It makes it all worthwhile. So I can recommend it to anybody that wants to get in the industry. It's the best foot in the door because you're showing that you can do it. You've understood how to actually ship a mod and realize a dream, as opposed to just thinking about how cool making games is.
Well, it sounds awesome, guys. How do I get my hands on Dystopia?
Well, you can hit up our website, which I'm sure the URL is showing, and jump on the downloads page, grab it. You'll have to have Half-Life 2 to install it. And then once you're downloading it, get on the forums, have a chat. We've got a vibrant community, a lot of really cool people in the community that'll help you get up and running and understand the game and get in and kick ass.
Free download?
Absolutely free.
Excellent.
If only they knew how hard my life has been, they would have been fighting me out.
We'll be right back.
one day, happily playing in the jungle. The next being experimented on. Luckily, I managed to escape to Australia. That's where Jungus found me poaching noobs.
Who is this Peanuts guy?
But now, I guess I'll have to find a new family.
Peanuts, do you want to play pirate ships now?
Oh, Peanuts, do you want a chocolate or banana?
Whee!
Dude, what you doing?
I saw the pole. I'm not blind. They want me out.
All right, look, I'll see what I can do, all right? Just stay put for now.
Boom shakalaka! The winner of the best review of the week is...
Good game!
Oh yeah, Super Toby Toko, whoa! Dude, what are you doing?
I'm looking for a job.
Well, like a profession?
Like a J-O-B.
Well, like herbalism, mining, tailoring?
No, like a RL J-O-B.
What the hell for?
What do you think pays the bills around here?
I don't know.
Me neither. That's why I should probably get a job.
You do remember what happened last time you went for a job?
So, Mr. Junglist, I see you've been in the armed forces, is that correct?
Oh, yes, sir. I've served under the command of both GDI and NOT.
And what qualifications do you have?
Well, sir, I get a 3-to-1 kill-death ratio on any server I join. I have an 1800 rating in AOM, which proves I've got some micro, tier 260 lock on Barthelis, and all the supplies to stocking shelves because... Oh, yeah.
Well, have you tried something like reviewing games?
Yeah, it's a good idea. I should probably go check that out, see what it's like.
Sweet. Can you grab some milk on the way out?
Yeah, doing good.
The man who gets paid to play.
Yeah, just been rocking out.
Guitar Hero, sweet.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's see the rig.
Yeah, all right. So, yeah, this is the room.
Nice.
Main PC, 360, PSP, various bits and pieces lying around.
Very nice. Yeah, yeah, so how did you get into game reviewing?
I think, you know, luckily through knowing some people, you know, who are in that sort of space writing. And it was just a matter of sticking your hand up and really sort of jumping in there and saying, I want to do it, and, yeah, putting the words on the page.
So for the gamers out there, I mean, being a reviewer is sort of like a dream come true. You get paid to play games. Is it? Like, is it all it's cracked up to be?
In some ways, I'd have to say it is. You know, it's a lot of fun. And, it, you know, it is one of those dream moments where you realise you're playing games and getting paid to do it. But it's a lot of hard work as well. You play games differently to the way you would, you know, if you were just playing it for fun. You've got to really sort of get through and do a lot of things that you might not bother doing. And you play some games that you don't like, and you have to finish them. I think you just become a bit more selective in which games you play for pleasure, because you do have to play a lot of different games. So certain games, you know, they have to really jump out to keep you coming back.
So why don't you take us through how you do a game review? Is there like a checklist, or what are the criteria that you put it up against?
You often spend a lot of time thinking about issues of, you know, first the technical issues, audio, the visuals, and then you might start thinking about, you know, the gameplay aspects, you know, level designs, AI, and, you know, characters, how interesting the storyline is, and then the raw sort of fun itself, you know, how fun it is to play.
You review a lot of games, so it'd be pretty impossible to get to the end of every one of them. Is there anything that the manufacturers do to make it easier for you?
you know, if it's the kind of game that needs to, you know, you really need to see the end, or you need to see, you know, make sure you've gone through every level, then you might get special unlock codes to see levels, or to, you know, help you jump to the end, play through faster, you know, unlimited lives, all that kind of thing. Plenty of people see these kinds of codes, you know, they come out after a while for a game. Other times, these codes might be kept secret, and you know, have to go into an agreement to make sure you don't actually reveal what the codes are.
Do you come up often against a game that you really like and you're really excited about, like when it comes out?
Yeah, number one game for me still after a good, you know, year and a half is still World of Warcraft. Mm. There's a game that's just been so hard to let go of. You know, I took a break for a few months and then came back to it and fell in love all over again.
From your perspective, what's the next big thing coming out that's going to sort of change the genre that it's in?
I was lucky enough to go to E3 this year, and at that, certainly, I really felt like Gears of War was definitely a game that really, you know, is going to do a lot for the team-based shooter type thing. That's the third-person environment, and really forcing people into playing a lot more of that cover-based shooter type activity, and with a lot of sort of new skills and new weapons and the new way of playing using cover. I think that's really going to do a lot for that genre.
Well, Seamus Byrne, thanks a lot for taking us into the world of game reviewing, man. Let's see your WoW character, dude.
Ah, you're back. How'd you go?
Good.
Good, because we're about to look at a game called Dead Rising. And to put in one sentence,
it's a zombie-killing game.
And if it were up to me, I'd probably leave it at that. But our friend here, Jungie, actually liked the game, so here we are. Now, if you're under 15, please turn away right now. Jungie.
All right, now first, Dead Rising, it's sort of confused as to what kind of game it wants to be.
Mommy! Oh, sweetie.
The great thing about it being on a next-gen console is that you can have heaps of zombies on screen at once. You've got timed missions, escort missions, and a little ticker at the bottom of the screen saying how many undeads you've clocked up. So it's obviously going for an Evil Dead sort of feel. But then they go and do something like give you a gun with only 10 bullets in it. Like, what am I gonna do with 10 bullets? You know, all of a sudden it's going for like a Resident Evil sort of feel where you've got really low ammo and you have to conserve it like a puzzle. I'm not here to solve a puzzle, I'm here to kick ass and chew some bubblegum.
Groovy.
That's it, but they do kind of make up for it by letting you use anything in the game as a weapon, from golf clubs to yellow pages to my personal favorite, the boomstick.
Oh, Jungie, you're so easily amused.
Look, man, it's a proven formula. Lots of zombies plus shotgun equals good game.
Yeah, but Dead Rising is just so repetitive. Dead Rising is just so repetitive. And the plot, it's just ridiculous.
Yeah, but no one goes to see a zombie movie for the plot. Come on.
Well, you're obviously a zombie killing fan, and if you like killing zombies, then you probably like it too. But I don't, so I'm gonna give it 6 out of 10 shooks.
All right, well, it's not the best game, but I did have a lot of fun with it. I'm giving it 7 out of 10 rubber chickens. Here's what our forum goers had to say. Oodles says, the best features are the massive amounts of options, the almost hilarious idiocy of the situation, and the sheer amount of stuff you can do in-game, as well as it looking incredible. Yakamo says, graphics was probably the biggest letdown of the whole game, as they felt very last-gen. And considering the power of the 360, it was even more disappointing. Okay, what's next?
All right, well, next on the menu, we have Caesar 4. This is a city-building game, and it's based on the glory days of the Roman Empire.
Our city is losing money.
We have an outstanding order that must be fulfilled soon.
Your job as governor is to build houses for different classes of citizens, build farms so your people can eat, and also theatres so they can be entertained, and most importantly, Roman bathhouses. Yeah, we all know what they do in Roman bathhouses. It's a pretty solid game. I haven't really played the old Caesars before, but I really enjoyed it.
Now, I have played the old Caesars, and I do agree with you it's a great game, but they really haven't come a long way.
And why is that?
Well, they've really just made it more complicated. In Caesar 3, you had a farm. In Caesar 4, you've got a farm and a field. Now, instead of having one type of market, you've got four different types of market. So it's more complex, which makes it harder. That's offset by the fact that the AI is improved, so all your tax collectors and prefects automatically know where to go, so that makes it easier. That plus a slight graphical improvement is really all they've done to improve the game. Now, consider Caesar 3 came out 8 years ago. For the content that you get, I think this is more of an expansion than a new release.
Okay, look, I enjoyed the gameplay. I thought it was a fun game. And if you've played Sims or SimCity, I think you'll enjoy it as well. So I'm going to give it 8 out of 10 chooks.
All right. It is still a great game, great gameplay, but I think you'd be better off going out buying Caesar 3 from the discount bin, crossing out 3 and putting 4, saving yourself some money. I'm giving it 6 out of 10 rubber chickens.
Good game!
Man, you suck at this game.
Yeah, I suck at all driving games, but you're no shoemaker yourself.
It's Schumacher. Hey, but you know who's actually good at driving games?
Who?
The Doc, man.
Daniil?
Yeah, man. He's been heaps of land comps. He's actually won some as well.
Do you reckon you can race over there and give me some tips?
It's a good idea. See you later.
What?
Old school, new school, new school, old school. If you like fast cars, let me show you some horsepower that's guaranteed to blow you.
Hi, paper zipper.
I think we can help you with that.
Dude, I've been getting some real hard times getting away from the cops. What can we do to beat this?
Well, we can kick it up a notch.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Let's do it. With the chasers, are there any special ways to get away from the cops, or...?
Yeah, sure, there's plenty of ways to get away from the cops. You can try and outrun them with lots of speed. Or you can try and outfox them by driving through sort of urban areas.
Yep.
And hopefully try and lose them.
So, I mean, how important is it to know your map and how to get away from the police in that scenario?
When you're just starting out, it's not that important, although when you get towards the end of the game and the chasers become really furious,
yep.
You definitely need to know your map. If you don't, you're cooked.
I'm a big fan of Subaru, especially the Impreza WRX. How important is car choice?
It's very important, actually. There is quite a large selection of cars in the game, and all of them are good for different things. Whether you want to make them look good for showing off, or whether you want to race them, or drift them, or whatever you like to do.
So they handle differently depending if they're rear-wheel drive or all-wheel drive and all that as well? You can feel that in the game?
They do to a certain extent, definitely.
So what cars do you have a choice of in the beginning? What would you recommend?
Well, when you start out, you've got a choice of Lexus IS300, Fiat Punto, and the Cobalt SS. Out of those, I'd recommend the SS probably, because you save $1,000 of your $30,000 starting cash. Which you can use to make your ride better. And also, it handles pretty well.
Take us through the track. Show us what you can do.
Sure thing. The main thing to watch for in this game is actually traffic. It's really hard to avoid the traffic in some areas, particularly where you're running blind.
Yep. So can you set different difficulties for traffic in this game?
You can change the amount of traffic that you're using in multiplayer, but for single player, you're pretty much stuck with what's on the road. Usually, you try and drive in the shoulder lane so that you're not going to run into traffic.
Wow, I just saw some kind of Neo slow-mo mode right there. What was that?
Yeah, if you're going around a really sharp corner, you can use slow motion mode, or you can also use slow motion mode if you're about to run into traffic. Basically, it gives you really quick reflexes and lets the car slide around really easily.
That's really cool. So what's the go with NOS?
Well, you can use NOS in a few ways. Obviously, you can use it to basically just go faster, but you can actually use it as a cornering aid. So when you're driving around a corner and you're starting to lose grip, if you tap the NOS button on, then you actually gain a bit of grip back because it slams the back of the car into the ground and off you go.
Wow, so for all you noobs out there, NOS stands for nitrous oxide, okay?
Two.
So how long did it take you to get good at this game? It
took me probably a couple of months. When you start out, it's fairly easy, but really mastering the hard tracks and the hard challenges takes quite some time, actually.
And playing this game online, does it take long to master that as well, or can you chat to other players? What can you do there?
Yeah, you can chat to other players. It's certainly much more difficult online because you're versing other people, not the computer. So they're able to react to situations that are a bit sort of unnatural that the computer normally couldn't cope with.
You hear that, people? Humans are better than computers. So what can you do to make your car perform better? You can do turbo, I guess?
Yeah, you can add all sorts of performance things like turbos, spoilers, better brakes, better handling, so suspension. You can also change all the visual aspect of the car too, so you can get tinted windows and obviously add vinyls and body kits.
All right, well, Dan, you've been an awesome help. Really appreciate all the tips. Now, I think I'm ready to take you on, so I'm gonna see you online. Time to jet.
Definitely.
I am out of here.
And now for the name of this game for this week. This week, it's the Guardian Legend. It was one of the first hybrid games. It had an RPG mode like Zelda, and also a shooting mode like Raiden. It was very hard, had great music, and it was also one of the first games to feature a female as the main character. If you're interested in playing it, you can probably find it pretty easily using an NES emulator.
Wow, congrats to anyone that got that one. That was a toughie. Next week, we've got Jeremy and Carl from Pure Lineage. They're an internet phenomena, and they're coming to Good Game.
And we'll be getting a masterclass in Battlefield 2.
Do some really nasty stuff like sniping people from a distance.
And don't forget to visit our website. Leave us a message or review. Kapowski, out.
Junglist out.